الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم صلي وسلم وزيد وبارك على عبدك ورسولك سيدنا محمد. So we're still in Surah Qaf, and the last time we talk about, we said that Surah Qaf is the main theme here is about the resurrection and the proof for this day of judgment. And that Quran tackled this issue from different angles. Sometimes from the absolute knowledge of Allah, then he encouraged a human being to look at the universe, different angle also the history and how many nations Allah destroyed in the past. They deny the message. And then in the middle of the surah, there is a journey. Take the human being, since Allah Ta'ala created us, till we die, the day of resurrection, till the people of hellfire go to Jahannam and the people of Jannah go to Jannah. So last time we talk about the people of Jahannam and the old dialogue that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentioned, and the both Qareen, the angel one will say this is the record, and Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will give the verdict, and then the devil Qareen also, he will say, it's not my fault, and all this dialogue. And all this come with a dialogue in Jahannam. It just, you see it in front of you. Even when Allah talk to Jahannam, it's also in the form of dialogue of also. يَوْمَ نَقُولُ لِجَهَنَّمَ هَلِ امْتَلَأْتِ. Are you full? Jahannam will reply, are there any more? Look, because this, all the dialogue, just like you see it in front of you. When he finishes this, then he ends this with the people of Jannah. May Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala make us among Ahlul Jannah. He said, وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ. Uzlifat, it means brought close. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala said, will brought the Jannah close to the believers. What does that mean? That is type of na'im also. That's Jannah, they will see Jannah. Jannah will come to them. Not they will go to Jannah. No, Jannah will brought close to them. Now we want to describe. And Allah Tabarakat, when He described the na'im Ahlul Jannah, He described in details that in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, when He talked about, He said that before the Ahlul Jannah go to their palaces or houses, they will go through a long path full of trees. Why he make that in details? Just like you see, you watch this scene in front of you. So he say, أُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And when the Jannah brought close to the believers, type of na'im also. غَيْرَ بَعِيد. It's not far anymore. And then he said, and Allah, Rasulullah told us that before the believers go to Jannah, they will go through the bridge above the hellfire to appreciate that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala saved them from hellfire. Number one. And number two, because also some believers, they will fall down in the hellfire for a while, and then they will come out of that and go to Jannah. May Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala protect us. So now the Jannah is close to them. أُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ. هَذَا مَا تُوعَدُونَ. That's how Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala, what Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala were promised you in dunya. You know, every single morning and evening, you say Sayyidul Istighfar. The best statement of Istighfar that Rasulullah taught us is Sayyidul Istighfar. Anyone knows this Sayyidul Istighfar? Raise your hand. Allahumma anta rabbi kon. Say it. Say it loudly. Huh? Allahumma anta rabbi kon. لا إله إلا أنت خلقتني وأنا عبدك. كون.
وأنا على عهدك وعهدك ما استطعت أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت أبوء لك بنعمتك
Good. Rasulullah said, this Sayyidul Istighfar, this is the master of all, any statement you'll see and seek forgiveness, this is the best statement in Bukhari. In the middle of this statement, you every single morning and evening you say, وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ. Oh Allah, I'm still in your ahd and wa'd. Wa'd is a promise. Ahd is a covenant and contract between you and your Lord. What's that? If you fulfill what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala command to you, Allah promise you to go to paradise. And He never break His promise. Now when the people come to Jannah, هَذَا مَا تُوْعَدُونَ. This is what we were promised you in dunya. Then he mentioned now why they deserve Jannah. Like he mentioned also in Hellfire, some characteristics. He always do that. Because some Muslims, when they read ayat of Nar and ayat of Jannah, they skip the ayat of Hellfire because they thought we are from Ahlul Jannah, there's no doubt. And when the Jannah come, also we are from Ahlul Jannah. We just enjoy this ayat. No one knows who is from Ahlul Jannah and Ahlul Nar. By, you can't name this fulan is from Ahlul Jannah. We have hope that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will give us Jannah. But Jannah is not just to say, my parents are Muslims, therefore I am Muslim, therefore I will go to Jannah. It's not like this. We have to work hard. That's why Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala always the characteristics that Ahlul Jannah deserve Jannah. So he say here, لِكُلِّ أَوَّاب. The first characteristic is أَوَّاب. Anyone who is أَوَّاب, he will go to Jannah. What's أَوَّاب? أَوَّاب come from أَوْبَ. أَوْبَ, it means to return to something. The one who always return to his Lord is أَوَّاب. And this أَوَّاب here, صِغَةً مُبَالَغَةً, means he constantly go back to his Lord. What does that mean? It means he always repent to Allah. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala created us and we have a lot of weaknesses. So we fill in sin and we commit sin. But the awwab is the one, once he commits sin, straight away he repent to his Lord. When Allah, what some ayat in Quran I like and I repeat it a lot, is the ayat in Surah Ali Imran, when Allah said, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. Hurry up, compete to a Jannah, to a forgiveness, and Jannah أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. This Jannah has prepared for muttaqeen. And then Allah described muttaqeen. He said, الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ والكاظمين الغيظ والعافين عن الناس. Those who spend their money in the sake of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Look, when they get angry, they remember the reward of Allah, so they can stop that anger. Those who forgive people. All these characteristics is understandable. But look at the fourth one. He said, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشًا. Those who commit a major sin. لا إله إلا الله. Among muttaqeen, a type of people, they commit a major sin. However, they repent straight away. Allah said, those type of people, they will enter paradise among muttaqeen. Please don't listen to all these characteristics and you may say, no, that's not for me. I'm a sinner. I commit a lot of sins. For those people, Allah bring this ayat. No, you can go to Jannah even if you did a lot of sins, with one condition, repentance. And make that repentance a habit for you. That we say, Awwab, constantly he returned to his Lord. That's why Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala command us five prayers day and night. Because this prayer is a chance for repentance. We commit sin and we come to the mosque to cleanse our sins. So that's number one, awwab, repentance constantly. Second, hafidh. Hafidh, hafidha is to protect something. How's that? Someone is protector. Protector what? Because Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala created us, He gave us eyes, ears, and He tests us. He said hafidh, it means He always constantly protect His eyes to see anything haram. Protect His ear to listen to anything haram. Protect His mouth to say anything haram. Protect His hand, His legs, His belly. All this, so He always, for this dunya, in this short life, He tried to do His best to protect this. This is the ahd, the covenant between us and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So that why is hafidh. You remember when Yusuf alayhi salam said, اجعلني على خزائن الأرض إني حفيظ عليم. I will protect this money. I will do it in the best way. So here also he protect his eyes, his limbs. That's awwab, repentance, and always protect what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala command you to protect. Then he said, من خشي الرحمن بالغيب. خشية. We have in Quran khawf and we have khashya. Khawf is fear. Khashya is type of fear. When the fear plus glorification, this is khashya. That's why Allah described ulama, innama yakhsha Allah min ibadihi al-ulama. Fear, that's also something very good. But khashya is a special fear. When you fear Allah, out of when you realize that the glorification and the azama of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. But he mentions something here. خشي الرحمن بالغيب. When that believer is alone and he can commit a sin, but what prevent him just because Allah is watching him or her. خشي الرحمن بالغيب. When he is alone. We have ghaib and we have shahada. Shahada when you are in public, in front of people. Ghaib when you are alone. Because when you are alone, your desires now become strong. And shaitan now whisper and become strong. So that type of people, when they, shaitan whisper to them, open, watch that website, which is full of haram. You are alone, no one will see you. And he remember or she remember that Allah is watching them. And he close or switch off that mobile phone just because no one there. Al-ghayb, because of khashiyatul rahman. And bear in mind, he said here khashiyar rahman. Didn't say khashiyal jabbar, khashiyallah. He said he has that fear and glorification of the most merciful. It means if you know the mercy of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that if you commit a sin when you are alone and you go outside in public and he never expose you. Hassan al-Basri said, imagine if when we commit sin, Allah put a smell for that sins. And when you come to the public, everyone will smell that. How can we live? Allah always cover us. And they give us chance after chance to repentance. So He's the most merciful. So when that person, when he is alone, remember Allah, he doesn't remember that Allah will punish him only, no. That he remember that Allah also will cover me. Allah will protect me. Allah is the most merciful. He deserves that khashya. من خشي الرحمن بالغيب. That's why, brothers and sisters, taqwa is all about when you are alone, how you are. When you are alone, that's your real version of yourself. It's easy for every one of us to pretend when we are in public that we are a pious people. That's easy. Come to the mosque and pray, and when you pray two rak'ah, and one of your friends come around you, you will pretend that you are so khashi'. Maybe you make it long. When you come to the house, do you do the same salah? Or that khushu' only when you are in public? So if you want to know really if you are khashi'a rahman bil ghaib, look at your prayer when you are alone. Look at your prayer when you pray some rak'at at house, not in public. Look at your character, not in public, no, at home. How you deal with your spouse, how you deal with the children, because you live with them all the time. You can't pretend different character. That's your real version. So Allah Ta'ala said, من خشي الرحمن بالغيب. Then he end with this, وجاء بقلب منيب. And he came to the day of judgment with sound heart. Qalb is heart, munib is again, anaba is returned to his Lord. He's like awwab. Why he constantly said awwab, return always, munib, return always, to give us hope. Don't think Jannah is just for those who never commit sins. No. Many people, they will be in high rank in Jannah. They were sinful. However, they repent. There's always hope. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that that man who killed 100 people, but now he have strong feeling, he want to repent, he want to change his environment. Allah Ta'ala said he is from among Ahlul Jannah because he died after repentance straight away. So Allah opened the door for hope always. So he start with that, start with awwab, and he end with munib. Start with repentance and end with repentance. But he said heart here. He want to indicate something very important. Brothers and sisters, every type of worship has two dimensions, has form and spirit. When you pray, you do ruku' and sujood and say something, this is all the form of salah. But the spirit of salah is where's your heart when you do this. That's the most important. When you raise your hand for dua, because you memorize this dua, you may only your tongue do the form of dua. Where's your heart? Heart in Quran, it means your mind and your heart. When Allah mentioned heart in Quran, he means two things, means mind and heart. Then why he didn't say mind? Because sometimes you understand something by your mind, oh, that makes sense, I agree with all this evidence, but you don't take action. There's someone who understands everything. Oh, I believe that all this evidence is sound arguments. Okay, what's after that? Will you believe? No. Hard is when that information in your brain come to a feeling. Heart is a place of feeling. I mean, fear of Allah, hope of Allah, that's in the heart. Before that, there's a process in your brain. So when he mentioned this, he mentioned heart, it means brain and heart. So it means when you raise your hand for supplication, I can say something and my mind is different place. Oh, I calculate my business now. And my tongue still make dua. How is that? That's the form of ibadah, not the spirit of ibadah. Allah always emphasizes qalb to tell you focus on the heart. focus on the spirit of ibadah. So he mentioned Ahlul Jannah, start with repentance, end with repentance. Then he said, Udkhuluha bisalamin aminin. Enter Jannah with peace. Salam here has two meanings. Salam, it means peace. And salam also means greeting. And both here is intended. So go with peace, because this is the Darus Salam. This is the home of peace. But also, the angels will waiting for them in the doors of Jannah to greet them. Subhanallah. As Allah mentioned in many places in Quran. So imagine, because you are, if Allah Ta'ala gave us Jannah, will become the guest of the most merciful, the most generous. So that's the job of angels, just to greet every single individual. And when they enter Jannah, one day they heard the best greeting ever. They will hear the greeting from Almighty. Salam qawlan min Rabbir Rahim. Allah the most merciful will greet Ahlul Jannah. You are my guest. So he said, idkhuluha bisalamin aminin. Amn here is safety. Amn is safety because this dunya is a place of test, of tribulation, of difficulty, of challenges. That day, there's a peace and tranquility. You will be safe. That's why every single salah, when we say Assalamu alaikum, after that you say Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam, tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Because salam is one of ultimate goal for Muslim. We need peace. Because this dunya is not a place of peace. You leave your son, and after a while, you lost your son. It's not a place of peace. You like to be in health all the time, and you become sick. It's not a place of peace. But Jannah, the angels will say, Ya Ahlal Jannah, you will be here forever. You'll have a good health, you'll never be sick in your life. You'll be in the same age, you'll never become old. Udkhuluha bisalamin. Thalika yawm. Then he said, Thalika yawmul khulud. That is the day of eternal life. That's why Rasulullah said, in the day of judgment, the angels will brought the death in the shape of goat. And they will slaughter that goat and say, O people of Jannah, you will be in Jannah forever. O people of Nar, you will be in Nar forever. A'udhu billahi minan Nar. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. They have whatever they wish. And Allah said, and we have for them more. We have for them more. It means everything you read in Quran about Jannah, there's a lot more you can't imagine. Everything in Jannah, Allah Ta'ala described, it's just type of Na'imul Jannah. Allah said, وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. We have more for them. Because Na'imul Jannah is two types. There's a physical Na'im and there is a spiritual Na'im. Physical na'im is what Allah described a lot in Ayatul Quran. You have that, a lot of trees and gardens and palaces and houses. You have all these fruits. That's physical na'im. There is a spiritual na'im. To feel that you live here forever, that's a spiritual na'im. Because you can't imagine it, someone to live forever. Peace that you will never heard any even single word that will hurt you psychologically. That's type of spiritual na'im. That when your parents in high status in Jannah and you are in lower status, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will gather all the family in the same status, in high status. That's a spiritual na'im. To see all the companions you read about them in dunya. You see Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali radiyallahu anhum, Sa'ad wa Sa'id, all these companions, great companions, you'll visit them, you'll talk to them. You say, I know everything about you. I heard about you in Jannah. That's spiritual na'im. To visit Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his palace in Jannah, that's a spiritual na'im. That's great. Imagine you sit with him and you know his life and biography very well. Oh, Rasulullah sallam, I was with you with my heart when you went to At-Ta'if and they did very bad thing for you. Oh, Rasulullah, I was with you when they hurt you in Uhud. Oh, Rasulullah, I was with you when you are in Hajjatul Wada'. Oh, Rasulullah, that's a spiritual na'im. Better than all of this, that one day Rasulullah said that Ahlul Jannah, they are in Jannah. And suddenly they will hear the voice. And the angels will say to them that Almighty want to speak to you directly. That's spiritual na'im. And the Almighty will say, oh, Ahlul Jannah, do you want more? They said, there's nothing more than this. You gave us everything. Anything we wish, we can find. What's more than that? He said, more than that, I will be pleased with you forever. You know, in dunya, you always ask, did Allah accept my good deeds? You always have this. In Jannah, there is no this feeling. Allah will please with you forever. And then we'll give them something else. That he said, yukshaful hijab. He will let Ahlul Jannah to see him, Almighty. The one who created everything beautiful in this life. If Rasulullah didn't tell us about this, this will not come even to our imagination. But that out of his generosity, tabaraka wa ta'ala. So he said, وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. If you heard all this na'im, will you spend this few years for something insignificant? Waste your time for something and Jannah waiting for you. And the only chance you have is this dunya. And you spend this dunya by wasting the time for committing sins, running for a lot of these desires. If you heard this Jannah, all the dunya will become insignificant. It's nothing. But because of this heedless, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala sometimes take one of our beloved, either friends, relatives, just to wake us up. Wake up! Jannah waiting for you. And you waste your time. So when that relative die, then you wake up. Every time we go to janazah, but if the deceased is not your relative, it doesn't affect you. Till you know someone, you know him very well. You have a lot of memory with him or her. When they die, that's strong. You will wake up. Strong reminder. Then after that, you will feel that this dunya is just like a dream. When my parents, may Allah give them mercy. My father died 2006 and my mom 2010. After my parents, especially my mom, I just feel sometimes this dunya is just like a dream. Because those who live with them for many years, you lost them suddenly. Just this life like a dream. So, out of his mercy, tabaraka wa ta'ala, he take one of your relatives or best friends just to wake you up. Because we need this wake up. How can we, all this na'im, and we still follow our desires. May Allah Ta'ala forgive us. May Allah Ta'ala give us Jannatul Firdaus. Then he said after that, now from ayah number 36 to the end, this is now the conclusion. In the whole Quran, the introduction and conclusion, when Allah makes introduction and you go to conclusion, he will summarize the, all these angles he talk about in different way. Concise, but slight different way. That's in the whole surahs. It just need type of reflection. So he said, وَكَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا قَبْلَهُمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ هُمْ أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ بَطْشًا. How many nations? How many here? It means there's a lot of nations we destroyed before them. Did Allah mention that He destroyed nations before in Surah Qaf? Yes. كَذَّبَتْ قَبْلَهُمْ قَوْمُ نُوحٍ وَأَصْحَابُ الرَّسِ. And this is in the beginning. Now He mentioned in the end, but in different way. He said those nations أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ بَطْشًا. They are more stronger than you. Allah gave them everything. And then he said, فَنَقَّبُوا فِي الْبِلَادِ. I look at all the translations here in English. And all the translation I look at is just take one opinion, which I don't support this opinion. They all said that أَشَدُّ مِنْ فَنَقَّبُوا فِي الْبِلَادِ. It means they travel everywhere and there is no escape. Yes, this is one opinion in tafsir. But there is another opinion which is more stronger. And unfortunately, the English translation, they don't mention this. نَقَّبُوا فِي الْبِلَادِ. It means they build a lot of buildings, castles, bridge. They made a strong civilization. And in the end, they die and left all of this behind them. هَلْ مِنْ مَحِيصٍ. Is there any escape? Is there any place you can escape from your Lord? Okay, you now in this earth and you did a lot. What after that? You will die and come to the grave. So he tackled this issue of nations, which he mentioned in the beginning of the surah, but in different also, slight different method. That always, that's why he said straight away after this, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى. In that, what's that? Maybe what Allah mentioned in this surah from the beginning till here. لَذِكْرَى, reminder. But not everyone who will take the reminder. Allah said those who will get benefit of reminder is those لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبْ أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدْ. For one who has a heart. Wait a minute. Do you know anyone in this life doesn't have heart? Did you see a person without heart? Can we live without heart? So did you see anyone without heart? Is there anyone doctor here? Any doctors here? Maybe they see something we don't, they always make surgery or something. We just see what appearance for us. Is there any doctor tell us, did you see anyone without heart at all? So everyone has heart. Why Allah said, reminder, the only one will get benefit of reminder is the one with heart. It means there's a spiritual heart and physical heart. There's a spiritual eye and physical eye. This is physical eye, but there's a spiritual eye. There's a physical ear, but spiritual ear. And that theme in Quran is one of the main themes in Quran. That he said there's some people they have physical eyes, but they can't see the truth. They have a physical ear, but they can't listen to the truth. They have physical heart, but they don't take the reminder. So he described them, summun bukmun umi. Sum is deaf. Deaf spiritually, not deaf physically. In another word, Allah gave us this, eyes or ears or heart, mind, all of this for a reason, to receive the revelation. to understand the words of Allah and act upon it and live your life according to the revelation. If all these senses doesn't benefit you, then just like you are deaf or blind or you don't have heart. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ. Then he said, أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. Here he said, they listen attentively. But Allah said, أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ. سَمْعَ is hearing. ألقى, it means you do like this. Just your سمع, take it and give it to one, you will listen to it. Just a metaphor. It indicates that you listened attentively. But ألقى here, this word, we heard it in قاف before. ألقيا في جهنم. Every surah has certain words Allah repeat in different way. That's what the character of that. Every surah has a certain character. So ألقى السمع وهو شهيد. Shaheed in Quran has different meaning. What does shaheed mean, guys? Can you tell me any meaning of shaheed? Witness. There's a lot in Quran also. Shaheed. Another meaning? Martyr. نبيين والصديقين والشهداء. Another meaning? Participant. So shaheed come different way because shahida, it means you attend a certain place or situation. So that's why you are a witness. Martyr is shaheed because what he did for the sake of Allah is a witness that he deserves Jannah. Also, when you are here and attend the situation, to be a witness, you have to listen attentively. If you attend any difficult situation and they ask for your witness, come here, you are a witness. You are a witness, it means you hear attentively. You look and you was very focused. That's what here. ألقى السمع وهو شهيد, it means he is very focused. When he listened by his mind and his ears. Listen to what? To the revelation. Listen to what? To what Allah gave us lessons in history. Listen to all the evidence that Allah brought for to make sure that this, the day of resurrection is يوم الحق. And Allah said, لمن كان له قلب أو ألقى السمع. Some scholars say some people, they just need to reflect by their minds and their heart and they will receive and accept truth immediately. Some people, they need to do a lot of research. ألقى السمع وهو شهيد. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, straight away, he became a mu'min in the first moment. But some people need also. But both are okay. But the problem is when Allah give you that heart, ear, eye, and you don't use it to receive this message. Then he said also another thing he mentioned before, the same angle from a slight different also way. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ. He mentioned before, أَوَلَمْ يَنْظُرُوا إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَوْقَهُمْ. He mentioned before, وَالْأَرْضَ مَدَدْنَاهَا. He mentioned السماوات and earth before. But in conclusion, he will also mention all of this summary in concise way. We created heavens and earth and everything in between in 6 days. وَمَا مَسَّنَا مِنْ لُغُوبِ. لُغُوبِ is tiredness. Massana, even not even everything tiny of tiredness touch us. It means we never come tired because why he mentioned this? Because this here, an indication for something. That's why he separate this ayah with walaqad. Because the people of the book before us, they said, the Almighty created heavens and earth and then he take one day rest. That's why they celebrate a Saturday, for example, Because they said this is the day where the Almighty take rest. Allah said, وَمَا مَسَّنَا مِنْ لُغُوبٍ. It's impossible that the one who has absolute power become tired. It's impossible. So then he said, وَلَقَدْ. Then in the end of surah, he will end and gather all these themes in amazing way and in fresh reminder also of the day of judgment. Inshallah, next time we'll end Surah Qaf and we talk an introduction about Surah Al-Hujurat bi-idhnillah. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala give us Jannatul Firdaus. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala gather us and our parents, our children, our spouses, our brothers, our sisters, our relatives, and all the Muslims around the world, and all the Muslims, they die before us in Jannatul Firdaus. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala make the last word of our life La ilaha illallah. May Allah make us among those awwabin. Whoever commits sin, they repent straight away. May Allah accept all our good deeds. May Allah relieve the all pain from our brothers and sisters in Gaza. May Allah strengthen them. May Allah give them tranquility in their heart and peace. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala give them patience. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala give them yaqeen. في الله تبارك وتعالى وصلى الله على عبد رسول سيدنا محمد